Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Hidden Corpse by Debra Sennefelder. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. Chapter 1. Still missing. No new leads on Lily Barnhart. Hope Early stopped scrolling on her tablet when she came to the article. Her interest piqued by the ongoing saga about how the 41-year-old architect went missing 3 weeks earlier, after last being seen by her husband when she left for work. Hope shook her head in disbelief. How could the police have no new leads? A woman simply didn't vanish. Lily disappeared on a damp, rainy day. Hope remembered because it had been a perfect day for baking. She'd spent hours in her kitchen testing banana nut bread recipes. The first three attempts resulted in so-so breads, but with the fourth try, she had perfected the recipe for her blog, Hope at Home. When she worked on recipe development, she blocked out the world around her. It was just her, the recipe, and the ingredients. So it wasn't until later in the evening when she'd settled down for a cup of tea and a slice of bread that she'd learned Lily had gone missing. By morning, her hometown of Jefferson, Connecticut was abuzz with speculation, and the fear for Lily's safety was palpable. I can't believe she just vanished. Felicity Campbell sat down next to Hope at the long table that was set up for the four students attending the food photography course. Hope looked up from her tablet. She met Felicity when they both auditioned for the reality television show The Sweet Taste of Success. Hope was chosen as one of the 13 bakers to compete for the grand prize, while Felicity was encouraged to audition for another season. Hope left the show as the first runner-up with a small monetary prize and a broken marriage, so maybe Felicity had won after all. It's scary, isn't it? The thought of leaving her house one morning and never returning sent a shiver down Hope's spine. Since you live in town, did you know her? Felicity's auburn hair was pulled back into a loose ponytail, and her makeup was heavily applied, which was a bit much for a food photography class. She was known for posting selfies on her blog, Felicity Cooks with Style, so Hope figured she always wanted to look camera ready. Hope doubted any of her readers wanted to see what she looked like when she was in the midst of cooking. Her shoulder-length dark hair was usually pushed back in a headband, her face was makeup-free, and she preferred to cook in her comfortable lounge pants and loose t-shirts. She hardly looked camera ready when she was in her kitchen. Not really. I saw her a few times in town. Hope closed the website and set her tablet on the table. The last thing she wanted was her photography instructor peering over her shoulder and seeing an article about his missing wife. This must be a nightmare for Cal. I thought for sure he would have canceled this class. Felicity raised her cell phone, leaned in closer to Hope, and angled the phone toward them. Selfie, she cooed. Within seconds, she was tapping a message to accompany the photo of them on her Facebook page. I tagged you. Thank you. Hope was glad she opted to apply a little blush to her usual mascara and dusty rose lipstick for her class. Felicity finished checking her Facebook page and set her phone down. I've been so excited about this workshop for months. I'm really glad he didn't cancel, though I'm not sure if I was excited about being taught by Cal Barnhart himself or finally seeing his studio. It's awesome, isn't it? Yes, it is. Hope looked around the large space where Cal worked when he was home in Jefferson. A dozen floor-to-ceiling windows allowed for natural light to flow in, and brick walls gave the expansive space character. Baker's racks were packed with props, and a fully functioning kitchen was tucked into the corner for food preparation. His photography class used real food, and from where Hope was sitting, she saw Cal's assistant working in the kitchen. This place is awesome. Lewis Maddox pulled out a chair and sat across from Hope. The 30-something writer behind the This Man Grills blog was dressed in a short-sleeved plaid shirt and khakis. He wore dark-rimmed glasses that kept sliding down the bridge of his nose. Barnhart's cool factor is off the charts. especially since his wife disappeared and it's an active missing person case. What a terrible thing to say. Elena Voss approached the table. She was the main recipe developer behind the Two Chicks and a Stove blog. Upon meeting Hope, she quickly listed all of the magazines her recipes were recently published in. Hope was impressed by the woman's professional pride and the ability to ramble off multiple titles without taking a breath. Really? Tell me you ladies don't think he's even hotter now that there's a hint of scandal around him, Lewis challenged. Felicity nodded. He's right. Callie's hotter now. Elena let out an exasperated sigh as she sat down next to Felicity. What about you, Hope? What do you think? She'd always admired Cal's work. But now that he was in the midst of a scandal, there was an air of mystery about him, and mystery could be, as Lewis said, hot. Not that Hope would ever admit that to anyone, especially the three bloggers surrounding her. Okay, let's begin. Everyone, take a seat. Cal Barnard's voice boomed as he entered the studio, clapping his hands. He got everyone's attention. Even his assistant stopped what she was doing to focus on him. He was tall, lean, and ruggedly artistic, a potent combination for any woman to take in, and Hope understood Felicity's assessment of him. He wore his trademark black, his dark hair was peppered with flecks of silver, and his deep blue eyes cast a sweeping glance over his students. How do you create sexy food photography that your readers can't get enough of? Cal asked, his intense gaze landing on Hope. She shifted in her seat, and the studio suddenly seemed warmer than the cool May morning. This wasn't college, and she wasn't a silly freshman who flirted with instructors, especially one with a missing wife. Your goal is to entice your readers with your photographs. Make them stop from clicking off your website. Grab them. Pull them in. Keep them. If your photography is lackluster or substandard, I guarantee your reader will be off your blog before you can say Google Analytics. His students chuckled. Hope lifted her gaze and found Cal had moved over to one of the tables set up for their class. He now was looking at the whole group, not just her. Shouldn't our recipes be enough to keep our readers on our blog? Elena asked. If you believe that, you wouldn't be here, Cal replied dryly. I'm all for learning how to create sexy food photos, Felicity gushed in a breathy voice. I doubt any of my grilled bratwursts will ever be considered a sexy photo, Lewis quipped. You can make any food look delicious and appealing. That's your job. And the reason why you're here today. We're going to begin with lighting. Then we'll cover styling, editing, and angles. Angles are easy. I have two preferences. Cal picked up his digital camera. I wouldn't mind being angled by him, Felicity whispered as she leaned over to Hope. Come on, you have to be thinking that too. Actually, I was thinking of why he chose that lens to use. Hope pointed at the camera Cal held. She'd invested in two lenses when she purchased her digital camera for her blog, but he was using a different lens. She was curious to find out how the lens performed compared to the two she owned. Felicity rolled her eyes. Boring. We'll begin with shooting bowls of oatmeal and fruit. See, what we want to accomplish is snapping a photo that will go viral. Everybody and their mother will want to make your recipe, so let's get started. Everyone to their table. Cal clapped his hands again. Cal's assistant had set out a bowl of oatmeal and berries with a gingham napkin and a spoon at each station to be photographed to death. Hope grabbed her camera bag and walked to one of the tables. There wasn't anything fancy about Cal's setup. Its simple functionality gave the space a cool, hip, urban vibe. Each station consisted of a 4-foot table topped with a thick board. She ran her fingers over the rough surface and had some serious prop envy. Stacked against the wall was a stash of boards in various sizes and finishes. Hope had a similar growing collection, but Cal's selection was huge. She spent weekends scouring flea markets and home centers for creative backdrops, trying to find a mix of wood boards, laminates, and stone to get just the right photograph. She pulled out her camera and attached one of her lenses, all the while keeping an eye on Cal. Countless questions ran through her mind, probably the same questions everyone in town was asking. How was he able to live a normal life with his wife missing? Was she dead or alive? Did she take off with someone or did someone take her? Cal's head turned and he caught her staring. He flashed a smile and she wanted to crawl under the table. She broke their eye contact and returned to adjusting the focus on her camera. He moved to Elena and assisted her with setting up a softbox to diffuse light, giving the photographer more control over the shoot. "Flirting with the teacher," Felicity whispered as she passed by Hope on the way to her table. Hope cleared her throat and returned her attention to her camera and bowl of oatmeal. How Cal was dealing with the disappearance of his wife wasn't her concern. She was there to improve her photography, not to stick her nose into his private business, no matter how curious she was. The workshop ended at 3. For over 5 hours, Hope was standing and, even though she wore sensible shoes, the same ones she cooked in for hours, her lower back ached. The pain probably was due to the various angles she contorted her body into to get hundreds of photographs. At one point, she even used a 3-foot ladder to get overhead shots. A nice, long soak in her tub would go a long way in easing the tension that spread across her back. But she had one stop to make on her way home. Drew had texted her right as class ended and asked to meet for coffee. She pushed open the door of the coffee clique and found a mid-afternoon rush of desperate caffeine seekers. A long line at the counter snaked around carefully laid out posts while two harried baristas whipped up fancy coffees. Her shoulders sagged. Oh, the last thing she wanted was to stand in line for a coffee she desperately needed. A quick glance around the coffee shop revealed every table was taken, but then she saw Drew waving her over. Bless him, he'd grabbed a table for them. She passed by the line of customers, smiling at familiar faces. When she reached the small table, she draped her purse on the back of the chair and sat. In front of her was a large coffee cup and a pastry. "Luckily, I got here before everybody else in Jefferson started jonesing for a coffee. I ordered you a hazelnut and the cinnamon bun. I know they're your favorites." Drew gave a big smile as he stood. He looked like the picture of cool casualness in a turquoise-colored polo shirt paired with pleated dark blue pants and two-toned blue sneakers. Hope glanced at her simple outfit of a floral top and khaki capri pants. She seriously needed to up her fashion game. Drew gave her a peck on the cheek and then returned to his seat. Something was up. She knew Drew too well not to be suspicious of his doting. He'd been her closest friend since grade school. They'd grown up together, went through breakups together, and shared the ups and downs of their careers. While Hope went off to New York City, he stayed in Jefferson and worked for the North County Gazette newspaper. "Thank you. I'm starving." She took a sip of her coffee. "I know you've had a long day in class, so I didn't want you standing in line for your coffee." He glanced over at the counter. "They really should get more help." Hope bit into the cinnamon bun. The layers of sweet, soft dough melted together with the heavenly sugar glaze topping, and bursts of cinnamon exploded in her mouth. She needed to figure out a way to make cinnamon buns a food group required at every meal. After she swallowed, she wiped her mouth with a napkin. Now it was time to find out what Drew wanted. "You're being very kind to me." "Well," Drew waved his hand in a dramatic gesture, "it's my pleasure. After all, you're my best friend." Hope nodded as she chewed another bite of the pastry. "I am. And best friends are happy to do things for their best friends, I suppose. So, it was my pleasure to make sure you had your favorite coffee and pastry." Drew leaned forward and rested his arms on the table. Hope wiped her mouth again, discarded the napkin, and then took a sip of her coffee. While she was confident something was attached to her afternoon treat, She had to admit she was enjoying being taken care of for a change. She couldn't remember the last time someone fussed over her. "What do you want?" she asked. Drew grinned. "That obvious?" Hope laughed. "Yes." Drew took a long drink of his coffee before confessing his ulterior motive. "I want every detail of what happened today." "Since when are you interested in food photography?"
"I'm not.
I'm interested in Cal Barnhart, more precisely, his missing wife." Hope shook her head. Oh, she should have known. Every reporter from local newspapers to the wire services wanted an interview with Cal. During the 5 hours she was at Cal's studio, which was located on his home's 5 acres, he never once mentioned Lily. When they broke for lunch, they all gathered around a picnic table outside under a majestic maple tree and ate a catered lunch his assistant picked up. Their conversation revolved around photography and blogging, and a bunch of photos were snapped for everyone's social media platforms.
"There's nothing I can tell you. He didn't talk about Lily during the class. We weren't there to discuss his missing wife."
The workshop cost Hope an exorbitant amount of money, so the only thing she wanted to talk about was photography. Food blogs that earned decent money had great food and awesome photographs, reason number one to sign up for the class. The other reason was to up the ante on her camera skills, because she'd been approached to contribute to a cookbook being published by The Sweet Taste of Success. Along with the recipes, she needed to include photographs. Drew slumped and his face twisted with frustration. "I've been trying to land an interview with him since Lily disappeared. He shut out all media. I can't even get a no comment out of him." Drew reached across the table, broke off a piece of the cinnamon roll, and chewed it. Hope couldn't blame Cal for staying away from the media. After her loss on The Sweet Taste of Success and her subsequent divorce, she was on the receiving end of some negative coverage in newspaper gossip columns and on celebrity websites. In the past couple of weeks, she had seen Cal receive some of the same treatment, but his case was worse, since husbands were always the first person the police looked at when a wife went missing. "I need that interview. I need an exclusive." Drew rubbed his temples and exhaled a deep breath.
"You know him personally?"
"Barely, and only through blogger events and some work at the magazine years ago." "What's going on?" Drew set his hands on the table, then laced his fingers together.
"Remember what I told you a few weeks ago about budget cuts at the newspaper?"
Hope nodded. The newspaper's publisher had gathered the staff together for an impromptu meeting to announce that the Gazette was in financial difficulty and would be looking at ways to reduce expenses, including layoffs. To recover from the stung announcement, Drew showed up at her door that night with a bottle of wine, a container of ice cream, and a list of movies he wanted to watch.
"You're very good at your job, Drew.
I don't think you have anything to worry about," Hope reassured.
"I have a lot to worry about, and she has a name."
"Nori."
"You got it.
The new shiny star of the Gazette. She ran out of the office today because she landed an interview with Lily's secretary. If I don't get something exclusive or juicy, I'm out. Out!"
Hope reached out and covered his hands with hers. "Drew, calm down. You're overreacting," Drew harumphed. "You're not going to get fired."
"Not if I can get an interview with Cal Barnhart."
"Reach out to him again," Hope suggested.
"He'll just turn me down again."
"But I bet you can convince him to give me an interview."
Hope shook her head. "I'm not going to do that."
"But we're best friends, and you did ask what you can do for me."
Hope swiped her coffee cup and stood. "You're right. We are best friends. Next time, the coffee and pastry will be on me."
"I have to get going." Drew sighed.
"Good grief,"
Hope muttered. Drew pouted.
Hope sighed that time. "Fine. I can't promise anything."
Drew smiled.
"You're the best."
Hope turned and headed out of the coffee shop, shaking her head. She had no idea how she'd approach Cal about Drew.
"My friend Drew is a reporter and would like to interview you about your missing wife."
Not a bad start to getting herself kicked out of class.
Hope pulled open the glass door and stepped out onto Main Street. Maybe something more direct. Would you like to set the record straight that you didn't kill your wife and dispose of her body? Hope winced. Too direct. She walked toward her car, which was parked down the street. Lordy, how did she allow Drew to manipulate her so easily? Guilt. He knew her too well. At least she had 3 more days of the workshop to figure out how to approach Cal about an interview with Drew. She'd figure something out. Chapter 2. Hope's kitchen door swung open and she was unexpectedly greeted by her sister, Claire Dixon. She had one hand propped on her hip and her nude-colored lips were pursed. Where have you been? Your photography class ended over an hour ago. Uh-oh. Claire is channeling our mother. Sorry, I missed my curfew. Hope walked past Claire and dropped her bags on the table. She'd had a long day and just wanted to collapse on the sofa, but with the stern greeting she'd received, she doubted there would be any relaxation. She turned just in time to brace herself for the excited onslaught of her adopted dog, Bigelow. His ears flopped and his tail wagged, and he bounded across the antique pumpkin pine floor at record speed to welcome her home. She rubbed him enthusiastically. Having a dog wasn't on her to-do list when she moved back to Jefferson, but when his owners could no longer keep him, she jumped at the chance to take him. It's good Bigelow was here to keep you company while you waited. Claire gave the dog a sideways glance. She and Bigelow had a complicated relationship. He liked jumping on people and dragging his dirty paws on their clothing, while Claire preferred not to be pawed by dogs. Some company. He's been sleeping. Claire walked to the counter and picked up her protein shake bottle and took a sip. I finished at the gym early, so I thought I'd come by to see you. Even though she'd just come from the gym, Claire's makeup was perfect, and her long blonde hair was pulled back into a neat ponytail. Her bright capris and purple tank top were perspiration-free, and her sneakers looked like they just came out of the box. Hope shook her head in amazement. When she finished working out, she was a sweaty mess, while her sister looked like she stepped out of a magazine layout. Bigelow settled down and retreated to his bed, tucked in a corner of the family room. The kitchen was an open space that incorporated the cooking area, a dining space, and a family room. The large space was the heart of her home and where she did most of the work for her blog, so it made sense for Hope to have spent a huge chunk of her budget and time remodeling there first. What probably didn't make sense was buying an old rundown house when she was recently divorced and starting a new business. What are you doing here? Hope asked. Normally, she didn't arrive home to find Claire waiting for her, especially now. Claire had been juggling her career as a real estate agent and running her campaign for mayor of Jefferson with raising her 2 kids, while her husband traveled often for business. Sitting around Hope's house waiting for her usually wasn't on Claire's to-do list. Claire perked up. 2 things. She set the bottle down and walked around the island. I was at the workout fix, and you won't believe what I found out. Hope went to the refrigerator and pulled out a pitcher of iced tea, then poured a glass. As a real estate agent in a small town, her sister had access to a lot of gossip, and spending time at the only fitness center in town meant she could find out anything about anybody. After taking a refreshing sip, Hope asked, "What did you find out?" "Meg Griffin wants the position on the Planning and Zoning Commission that Lily Barnhart has, or had, whatever. Meg wants it." "Can she do that? Lily hasn't officially resigned." In the past few years, the topic of development had become a hot button for town residents, and Hope didn't envy Lily or the other members. From what she knew, serving on the P&Z Commission seemed to be wrought with headaches, primarily from unhappy homeowners. "She's been missing for 3 weeks. The P&Z Commission needs to vote on very serious matters. The town can't wait for Lily to get her act together and come back home if she did take off, and we can't wait to find..." "We can't just wait to find her body." That was what they'd all been thinking. While everybody in town wanted to remain hopeful Lily would return safely, there was an unspeakable truth they all knew was a possibility. She was dead. She wasn't the type of person to run off. She was far too responsible to do something so reckless. She worked as an architect, served on the P&Z Commission, volunteered at the senior center and the library. No, Lily Barnhart wouldn't have walked away from her life.
Hope? Did you hear me?
Hope snapped out of her thoughts.
What?
If Meg is successful in her bid, she'll be a nightmare on the board. She's more of a tree hugger than Lily was. Claire, it's true. At least Lily had common sense on her side. She was open-minded about development, and I do have to admit she had some good arguments against some of the proposed developments. But Meg? And her Society to Protect Jefferson group? Ugh, she'll veto all development projects in town. Hope shrugged. If Meg wants to run, you can't stop her.
True,
Claire said. However, I can find a candidate to oppose her.
Oh, boy.
Who? Hope dared to ask.
Moretta.
Are you serious? Hope eyed the protein shake bottle. Was it spiked? Because Claire would have to be drunk to even consider Moretta Kingston as a potential candidate. They'd both known the woman since childhood, and while some people loosened up as they got older, Moretta seemed to be more tightly wound. Rigid, righteous, and overbearing summed her up nicely. Moretta was pro-development. After all, her husband owned a real estate agency in town where Claire worked. Having Moretta on the P&Z Commission would definitely change the dynamics of the votes. Isn't the fact her husband owns a real estate agency a conflict of interest?
Pish!
Claire waved away the suggestion. Don't worry about the details. I've got this all covered.
You're running for mayor, which means you should be concerned about the details.
Claire shrugged. I need your support.
Well, Moretta needs your support.
I think there should be some kind of get-together where Moretta can do a meet-and-greet with everyone now that she's officially a candidate.
Hope arched an eyebrow.
Meet-and-greet. Who hasn't she met and greeted in these 60-plus years she's lived in Jefferson? Or rather, who hadn't she offended? Hope didn't want to emphasize the negative since her sister was excited about the plan.
I would do it at my house, but I think it's better if someone else who isn't running for mayor hosts the event.
Claire had a look Hope knew all too well.
Oh, no.
No, no. Hope shook her head. With her glass in hand, she walked over to the table and sat. She set the glass on a coaster and then unzipped her laptop bag. She had a blog post to write, and she needed to check her emails, and maybe her sister would get the hint she was too busy to continue this conversation. Claire swooped over to the table.
Come on, it'll be a piece of cake for you,
she snapped her fingers. A couple of hours, some beverages.
Oh, we could do an English tea.
You can serve scones. Everybody loves your scones, especially those chocolate chip ones you bake with the sugar sprinkled on top. So worth the extra time on the treadmill. Hope hated when Claire appealed to the baker in her.
Darn.
But she would remain firm.
You make it sound like it's no work at all. Invite people over.
If you haven't noticed, I'm swamped. I have this photography class, I have my blog, I have Bigelow to train, and I have to finish putting up the shelving in the garage. She wasn't sure when she'd be officially done working on her house, but she did know she was nowhere near that date. The construction crew had just finished building the garage, wrapping up 2 days earlier with the sheetrock and paint. She needed to install the organizational system so everything had a place and her garage wouldn't end up a dumping ground.
Oh, come on. Who are you kidding?
With your uber ninja-like entertaining ability. You know it'll take you a couple of hours to pull the tea party together. You love stuff like this, Claire pointed out.
True.
Gosh, Hope was so easily manipulated. First by Drew and now by Claire. But I don't love Moretta Kingston. Claire rolled her eyes.
Ugh, nobody does.
But you'll be doing this for Jefferson. For our town's future.
This is bigger than Moretta. Trust me. Before Hope could say something, the doorbell rang, sending Bigelow racing through the house to the front door. Hope leapt up and chased behind him at full speed. He had a bad habit of jumping on the door, leaving scratch marks. Since she'd spent hours stripping and painting the wood door, she needed to break him of the habit. The dog training book she bought said she needed to create a calm environment for the training, and she needed to invite him to the closed door. Well, he wasn't waiting for an invitation. He was already at the door and was excited by the prospect of a visitor. He was barking loudly and dancing on all fours. "Sit!" she commanded. A playful howl escaped Bigelow's lips. The medium-sized brown and white dog continued to dance as Hope approached. At least he wasn't jumping on the door. "Baby steps," she guessed. "Sit!" she commanded again, pointing with her finger. The dog obliged. He settled into a perfect sit position as Hope reached for the doorknob. She pulled the door open and found her elderly neighbor Peggy Olson on her front porch. Hope's smile faded when she saw the nervous look on Peggy's face. The petite woman wore a pair of white pants with a blue blouse and a matching cardigan. Her short, thin white hair was messy. Her brown eyes were wide with confusion and she was wringing her hands together. Hope immediately stepped out of her house onto the front porch and placed a hand on Peggy's shoulder. "What's the matter, Peggy?"
"Oh, my! I can't believe! Please, come over!"
Peggy kept glancing toward the road. She lived a few houses away in a beautiful Victorian home her niece, Meg Griffin, had been maintaining while Peggy was recovering at a rehab facility. Hope had heard from another neighbor Peggy was home, and she planned on visiting soon.
"Of course I will. Can you tell me what's happened?"
Hope's mind raced with scenarios of what could have happened in Peggy's house. She tamped down the uneasiness that was settling in her gut. There was no need to jump to any conclusions. "Remain calm," she told herself.
"I'm thinking we can have tea around 11.
Claire approached the doorway. She stopped when she saw Peggy.
"Oh, hi. How are you today?"
Peggy's gaze darted to Claire.
"Not good, dear. But please, Hope, come over. I don't know how I did it. I can't remember. Maybe I..."
She turned and began walking down the porch steps. "What's going on?" Claire asked. Hope looked over her shoulder.
"I have no idea. I'll be right back."
She dashed down the steps after Peggy.
"Take your time. I'll check your schedule and pick a date for the tea,"
Claire called out as Hope caught up with Peggy as the older woman stepped off the lawn and onto the road. Peggy grabbed hold of Hope's arm as she walked.
"Hurry, dear. There's so much smoke."
Hope did a double take. "Smoke?" She stopped. "Peggy's house was on fire?" Hope entered the gracious Victorian house behind Peggy through a propped-open back door. The home was built in the mid-19th century and was trimmed with elaborate gingerbread and painted a bright yellow. They walked through the butler's pantry to reach the kitchen. Hope winced at the excruciating beeping noise emanating from the smoke detector. She dashed over to the stove, which was high-end 30 years ago. A 6-quart yellow Le Creuset Dutch oven sat on a trivet next to the stove. She grabbed the potholder from the counter, lifted up the lid, and found a burnt heap of peppers and onions.
"Dear, please, make it stop!" Peggy pointed to the ceiling.
"Okay, I can do that." Hope returned the lid to the pot and looked around the kitchen. In its heyday, it was top of the line and still hung on to its grandeur, even though the shiny newness had worn off. A hand-painted tile backsplash lined the granite countertop, while a butcher block center island with intricately carved legs stood solidly on the terracotta tile floor. She hurried over to the table and pulled out a chair. She moved the chair to under the smoke detector and climbed up.
"Be careful!"
Peggy called out as she shuffled over to Hope and reached out a small, frail hand to steady Hope's body. Hope glanced down and smiled. If she lost her balance, she'd fall and Peggy would get squished. The hand resting against Hope's leg was doing nothing to keep her from falling, but she appreciated the gesture.
Finally, she was able to turn off the smoke detector and the high-pitched beeping stopped.
Oh, thank you.
Peggy helped guide Hope off the chair. The noise was making me crazy. I can understand. Hope returned the chair to the table and walked back to the stove. Would you like me to clean this pot out? Peggy nodded, then padded to the stove and looked at the pot. I made a mess, didn't I? Did you forget you were cooking something? I must have. I woke up to the loud beeping and smoke. You fell asleep with something cooking on the stove? Well, that can be dangerous. I really don't remember cooking. You see, Meg stopped by earlier with groceries, and she brought me some of those prepared meals from the store that I just have to reheat in the microwave, so I don't know why I would cook anything. What's in the pot? Onions and peppers, Hope said. Peggy frowned. I always made that for Ricky. I don't cook that anymore. Hope reached out and covered Peggy's hand with hers. Ricky was Peggy's late husband, and she doted on him. Now she was at an age when her mind could play tricks on her. She could have made the onions and peppers, thinking Ricky was coming home from work. Hope's heart ached for Peggy. Getting old wasn't easy. Let me call Meg and have her come over.
No!
Peggy grabbed hold of Hope's hand tightly. Please don't. Why not? She's your niece. Peggy's eyes clouded with fear.
She wants me to go into a nursing home. I won't. It was bad enough being in that rehab place. I won't leave my home.
Hope bit her lower lip as she considered what to do. Peggy, you fell asleep with something cooking on the stove. Maybe you shouldn't be alone. Tears streamed down Peggy's face. She tried to wipe them away with her bony fingers, but there were too many. Hope extricated herself from Peggy's hold and went for some tissues. She returned, and Peggy took the tissues. Peggy dried her face as she settled at the table.
I want to stay in my home. Ricky died here. I want to also.
Hope sighed. She sympathized with her neighbor and wanted to honor her request. She also knew she needed to be the responsible adult in the situation and call Meg.
I promise. I won't turn on the stove or oven, Peggy said.
Hope wrestled with what she should do and what she wanted to do. If Peggy were her aunt, she'd want to know she nearly burned down her house. But if she were Peggy, she'd want her wishes respected. Talk about being between a rock and a hard place.
Okay, I'm going to hold you to your promise, Peggy smiled. Bless you. Bless you.
With a heavy pot in hand and full of doubt, Hope left the house. Had she made the right decision in promising not to call Meg? There was a chance Peggy overexerted herself and was tired. She'd been home for only a few days.
Hello, Hope!
A familiar voice called from a short distance away. She was so deep in thought about Peggy, she hadn't seen her other neighbor, Gilbert Madison, walking toward her with his dog Buddy. Twice a day, Gilbert walked his golden retriever, or was it the other way around? Hope wasn't sure. Gilbert maintained the routine for Buddy's health, but she suspected Gilbert enjoyed being out and about, chatting with neighbors.
Hi!
Hope walked down the driveway and was greeted by Buddy. He and Bigelow had become fast friends, and they often had play dates. Sometimes she envied the factor dog had a more active social life than she did.
Everything okay with Peggy?
Gilbert asked as Buddy sat next to him. The 3-year-old dog was used to frequent stops during his walks because Gilbert liked to visit with his neighbors.
I'm not sure.
She shared with Gilbert what had happened, and even though Peggy promised not to cook, she was still worried. Gilbert nodded.
She's just come home. She probably overdid it. Mitzi saw her this morning out by the mailbox pulling up weeds. I'll ask Mitzi to check on her later.
Gilbert tugged on Buddy's leash and they began walking away.
Have a good evening,
he waved. Feeling a little better, knowing the Madisons would be looking after Peggy, Hope headed back to her house. She had a ton of work to do, so it looked like another long night ahead of her. She had a couple of blog posts to write and finish putting together the free ebook. The recipes were all done and photographed, so all she needed to do was the layout of the book. Claire left after Hope returned from Peggy's house to pick up her kids from sports. Bigelow wasted no time in reminding Hope it was dinner time. Beside his food bowl, he did his nightly dinner dance. She quickly dished out his meal, and while he ate, she prepared a simple pasta dish for herself. Once the dinner dishes were cleared, Hope prepared a cup of tea and settled at the kitchen table and started to work. She spent 20 minutes checking her social media, followed by a quick scan of her emails. An old friend from her days in New York City sent a link to an article on a gossip website about her ex-husband. He'd liked the spotlight too much to give it up and wrangled his own reality TV show. Even though she had work to do, she clicked on the link. She had no business wasting time reading gossip. Once the website was loaded and she found the story her friend linked to, she realized just how bad a decision it was. Has Tim Ward found his true love in Angelica Rios? Hope slumped in her chair. Her ex-husband had a new girlfriend. She closed the browser and opened up her publishing program to continue work on the ebook for her subscribers. She didn't have time to dwell on Tim and his new love, the ultra-lanky, boob-enhanced model Angelica. She tapped feverishly on the keyboard, only to stop typing mid-sentence. Against her better judgment, she opened her browser again and went back to the website and read the article that accompanied the photograph of the very happy couple in love. Tim Ward, ex-husband of food blogger and former The Sweet Taste of Success runner-up Hope Early, has dated several women on the reality show Life After the Big D. It looks like this time Ward has finally found true love with international model Angelica Rios. Hope huffed. Before she clicked off the website, she saw the links below the article under the title of More from Celeb Watch. Three links, and the first one read, Hope Early assists with murder investigations. Hope huffed again. The second link read, Hope Early's sister arrested for murders. Having her sister the person of interest for two murders a couple of months ago forced Hope into doing a little detective work of her own and nearly got her killed when she discovered the identity of the killer. She closed the browser again. While the web articles would remain forever, she was glad there would be no more sleuthing in her future. Chapter 3. Hope took a sip from her travel mug. She'd brewed a whole pot of coffee to get her morning started. Getting out of bed was a struggle, but it wasn't because of soreness, which had become a common problem after purchasing an old house that needed a lot of work. Rather, it was plain old exhaustion. The first day of her photography class left her mentally drained. She thought she had a good handle on snapping photos of her food, but she was wrong. There was so much to absorb from Cal's years of experience that her brain actually hurt. How would she remember everything he was teaching? If the class wasn't enough, she'd been dragged into Drew's drama, Claire's insane idea of hosting an English tea party for Moretta, worrying about Peggy's mental state, and, to top it all off, the cherry on the sundae was reading about Tim's new love, a leggy, boob-enhanced model. Yeah, last night was rough. After she swallowed her drink of coffee, she chided herself for not making it stronger. She needed full-on diesel to get through the day. She was the first one to arrive at Cal's studio. Hope had a thing for being on time, which meant she always arrived early and waited a lot. She settled at the long table in the middle of the studio space and opened up her website. She needed to schedule some of her posts, and a few quiet moments alone would allow her to finish the task quickly. She worked with an editorial calendar, something bloggers usually had a hard time utilizing, but with her background in magazine publishing, using the calendar came naturally to her. When all of the posts were scheduled with their go-live date, she let out a sigh of relief. Now, she wasn't too far behind. She was making headway. "Good morning. You're the first one here," Brenda Fowler, Cal's assistant entered the studio carrying two overflowing reusable grocery bags. "It's my nature to be early," Hope said. "Maybe because it's your last name," Brenda smiled. She carried the grocery bags into the kitchen. Hope laughed, like she'd never heard that before, but she didn't want to be rude. "Interesting observation," Brenda shrugged. "I didn't mean to interrupt your work." She unpacked the groceries and put them away. Hope closed her website and walked over to the kitchen. Maybe Brenda could help get Drew an interview. When Hope was a magazine editor, she had her own gatekeeper, and there were days she missed Kara. Brenda was Cal's assistant, which meant she was technically his gatekeeper. Maybe she wouldn't have to go directly to Cal and risk being thrown out of class. "I'm very grateful the workshop wasn't canceled. I'm learning so much. In fact, my brain hurt yesterday from all the information he gave us." Hope leaned on the counter that separated the studio from the kitchen. Brenda nodded. "He likes to keep busy." She folded the grocery bags and set them in a drawer. Her long maxi skirt flowed easily with every move she made. Her light brown hair was pulled back into a messy ponytail and her skin was bare of any makeup. "Oh, I can relate." Hope knew something about throwing yourself into work to forget what life was handing you. When she found out Tim had cheated on her, she went into her kitchen and didn't come out for days. She had over a dozen cakes and countless cookies to write about on her blog. Her kitchen, whether it was in her New York City condo or her farmhouse, was her sanctuary, where she'd bake herself right. "I suppose you can," Brenda exhaled a breath. "Unlike your fellow students, you know what it's like to be thrust into the spotlight when your life unravels. I only went through a messy divorce. Cal's wife is missing, and there's speculation swirling around him." Brenda straightened, her deep chocolate brown eyes narrowed. "It's a waste of time, speculating. Cal had nothing to do with Lily's disappearance. He loved her. He would never harm her." "Oh, I don't buy into that speculation. It's just what I'm seeing occur in the media." "Well, then the media can stuff it." Hope pressed her lips together to stave off the smile ready to emerge. Brenda's G-rated outrage and protectiveness over Cal was endearing. This was going to be harder than she expected. "Perhaps the media can help move the speculation off of Cal and back into finding the truth." Brenda gave Hope a pointed stare and challenged her. "How?" Hope couldn't believe she was going to say what was on the tip of her tongue. But Drew was her best friend, and she'd do anything for him. Almost anything. Within reason. Brenda's stare intensified, so she needed to get on with it. "An interview." Brenda laughed. Not a funny ha-ha kind of laugh, but a you-have-to-be-crazy-girl kind of laugh. "Absolutely not. Cal knows reporters will twist whatever he says. They do that." "All the more reason to do an interview with a responsible reporter. There are a few good, honest reporters out there." "Good morning. Isn't it a lovely day?" Felicity bellowed as she entered the studio with Lewis trailing behind her. "Too darn early. Take it down a notch already, Felicity." Lewis slugged over to the table where he dropped his camera and laptop bags. He pulled out a chair and plopped down. His clothes were rumpled, like they were yesterday. Hope wasn't sure if he changed or if he was just sloppy. "I'm going to check on Cal. He should be out ready to start the class." Brenda darted out of the studio, leaving Hope with a firm no on the interview. She'd have to approach Cal. "Lewis has been crabby since we met in the lobby of the inn," Felicity looked around. "Where did Elena go off to?" "Who cares?" Lewis rested his head in his hands. "Does he have a hangover?" Hope asked. Felicity shrugged. "Maybe. He drank in his room last night." "Did you all drive over together?" Hope headed back to her seat, with Felicity following. "Yes, we figured it would be easier to carpool." Felicity wore a jersey knit wrap dress with a neckline that plunged a little low for daytime. Her hair was styled to fall in soft waves about her shoulders.
Lewis leaned back and rubbed his face. A freaking rooster woke me up this morning. A rooster. Who has roosters anymore?
The Merrifields. His name is Sherlock. Hope pulled out her notebook and opened it to her notes from yesterday. Jane Merrifield and her sister-in-law Sally manage Jefferson's only inn, and they like to serve fresh eggs to their guests. Sherlock had been a staple on Main Street for years. Being a retired mystery author, Jane named her rooster after one of her favorite fictional detectives. Felicity, who seated herself next to Hope again, leaned over and whispered, "I saw an article online last night about your ex." "Of course she did." Hope inhaled a deep breath. Most of Jefferson didn't know the celebrity website existed, and she could possibly go weeks without anyone knowing that her ex-husband was dating a supermodel. But bloggers knew what was out on the internet. Felicity was no exception.
"I wish him well."
Hope meant it. Well, at least she wanted to believe she was the bigger person. Felicity chuckled. "I'm sure he's doing very well with that model. Sorry, I had to take a call."
Elena rushed into the studio. She claimed a seat at the table and shrugged off her cardigan. She looked a little confused as she dug into her bag and muttered under her breath. Hope sensed Elena had lost something.
"I was wondering what happened to you." Felicity pulled her camera out of its bag and cleaned the lens. "You know, I was thinking last night, it's rare for bloggers to get together in real life. So I thought you would all like to come over to my house for dinner one night. Nothing fancy, just good food and conversation," Hope suggested to her classmates.
"Sounds like fun. I'm dying to see your house," Felicity said.
"If you've got a grill, I'd be happy to cook something," Lewis offered.
"Dinner sounds lovely," Elena chimed in. They were all in.
Great. They set a date and time. Hope began mentally preparing the menu while they waited for Cal to arrive. The door of the studio swung open and she expected to see Cal. Instead, Brenda marched in with a scarf in her hand. She approached Elena and extended her hand.
"I believe you dropped this by the back door of the house," Brenda said in a tight voice.
Elena looked sheepish as she snatched the scarf from Brenda and tucked it into her canvas tote bag.
"You know how much longer we have to wait?"
Before Brenda answered, Cal strode into the studio and stopped when he reached the long table where the bloggers were seated. Unlike the day before, he looked tired. His dark eyes were hooded, and the machismo he had exuded had been taken down a notch. Maybe teaching the class was too much for him with everything else going on in his life.
"We're going to begin with lighting today. I'll demonstrate first. It takes experimentation and practice to master good lighting."
Cal moved over to one of the small tables and picked up his camera. "The setup I'm using is simple because when you're photographing in your kitchen, you'll be limited in what you can use."
"With him, lighting isn't what I want to master," Felicity said in a low, throaty voice, just loud enough for Hope to hear.
Hope shot her classmate a glance. Maybe getting together with other bloggers wasn't such a good idea. She refocused on Cal, and the workshop flew by so quickly that by the time it was the end of the day, she was surprised. Even though the class officially ended, Cal remained to answer questions. When the informal session finally broke up, Hope left the studio with the group. After setting her bags on the back seat of her SUV, she realized she'd left one of her lenses on the table in the studio. She headed back to the studio and saw Cal walking toward her with her lens in his hands.
"Great, you have it."
She took the lens from Cal.
"How are you enjoying the class so far?"
"I have to admit, I'm a little overwhelmed, but it's amazing. I'm learning so much."
"It's hard to teach everything in a short period of time. With that said, I think everyone in the class had a good grasp on the fundamentals, and implementing just a few of my suggestions will definitely improve everyone's photographs."
Cal fell into step with Hope as she walked.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.